Good morning. Welcome to St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church in Maple, Ontario. It is Sunday, December 11th, 2022, the third Sunday of Advent. Now, if Advent hasn't gotten you ready for Christmas, perhaps the wonderful snowfall that we've had today will get you into that mood. Well, I'd like to welcome today. We have a speaker. It's been a while since Paul has been here before. We have Paul Q. Paul came to Canada in 1988 from South Korea. Obtained his Bachelor of Theology from McGill University and completed his Master's of Divinity from Knox College. And he is a certified candidate to become a minister in Pickering Presbytery. So we are going to welcome Paul, but before that, we're going to do our Advent liturgy. So just let me pass over the camera to Jackie and Dale.
We are people of joy.
God causes flowers to bloom in the desert.
Can you just pause for a second? Go ahead, Dale.
We are people of joy.
God causes flowers to bloom in the desert. The wilderness is glad and breaks into song.
We open our eyes and we are surprised by joy in our lives.
The third candle of Advent reminds us that we are called to live as people of joy.
We light this candle, recalling moments of laughter, great beauty, and deep faith.
Let us pray.
Holy One, regardless of what happens in our lives or in our world, may we reflect the warmth and wonder of this flame. Make your church a place of joy and light in our community. Amen.
All right, so now, friends, let me welcome Paul up to the microphone. Go ahead, Paul. Oh, sorry, I forgot. Hope is a star. So let's all sing the third verse of Hope is a Star, which is joy.
Joy is a song that welcomes the dawn, telling the world that the Savior
Yeah, please be seated. Good morning this morning. How are you, everyone?
You're well.
It's nice snow this morning. Yes, let us join our worship together by our call to worship. The light shines in the darkness.
We come to worship, seeking the joy Mary sang to welcome her Savior.
Source of light, shine into our lives. And your world this Advent.
Renew us in the joy of your salvation.
Our first theme comes from our book of hymn book, the 118, Hark the Glad Sound.
Please stand if you are
able. Stand.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Let us pray our prayer of adoration. Creator God, maker of heaven and earth, with the sea and the stars and everything in between, we praise you for the wonders of this world and beyond it. You set all creation in relationships, both fruitful and fragile. You make desert bloom and refresh the earth with the seasonal rain. With your care for the vulnerable in our hearts, we praise you with a joyous song this day. Our God, who is the source, savior, and spirit of life, perfect in unity, splendor, and truth, we continue our prayer as prayer of confession. Gracious Judge, we look around us and we are not proud of what we see. People criticize each other and listen only to those who agree with them. We grumble and think the past holds the solutions, forgetting its inequities and iniquities. We are impatient for things to improve, but we do not want to change our ways. Forgive us for sharing in the unhappy mood of our times, and renew in us the joy and gratitude we once knew for your gifts to us in Christ Jesus. Amen. My brother and sister, receive the good news in joy. With the great mercy, God forgives what he has confessed and offer us new life in Jesus Christ. Rejoice that you can make a new beginning and share the joy in mercy and forgiveness with others. It's time for peace of Christ. It is the time for greeting in our ancient churches. God's people welcome and greeted their brother and sister by saying, "Peace of Christ be with you." Let us greet each other by saying the same phrase, "Peace of Christ be with you."
Peace of Christ be with you.
Peace of Christ be with you.
And also
peace, peace. Well, it's time for kids. Where are they?
There's a couple here in the front.
Are you sure? Oh, yeah, I saw them. You know, it's way taller than me, actually. Yeah, but anyway, we are all God's children, right? No matter who you are, no matter what you are, how old are you, it doesn't matter. We are all God's children. Today, I'd like to speak about some, you know, the repeat after me saying. Everyone, please repeat after me, right? Are you ready?
Ready.
Ready? Are you sure? Okay, let's go. I say red.
Right.
Red.
Red.
White.
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 Black.
Black. Black.
Green.
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 Green. Green.
Now, what's the color of grass?
What is the color of grass?
What is the power of red?
Color of grass.
Oh, power of grass. It's green.
Green. What about you? Green, that's right. Wow. Well done. Well done. But in fact, I just tried to trick you. Sometimes people will forget that they are supposed to repeat after me. That's what I just said, right? But you didn't. You just said green. You're just answering me, my question.
That's right.
All right? Yep. I'm a big tricker. Okay, today, so what do you think of my try and trick you? What do you think? You feel good or you feel kind of, it's not bad, or you feel kind of bad? What do you think?
We're interacting.
That's right, you know. Keep that feeling in mind, because in today's scripture, we hear about the group of religious leaders called Sadducees. You all know the Sadducees. They were trying to trick Jesus in a very mean way. They're so mean, eh? They were trying to trick him with a question. What kind of question? Oh, what happened after we die? So what did Jesus say? Jesus gave a yes or no answer, because Jesus knows that if Jesus say yes or no, then they can make fun of him. That's their intention, to raise a kind of question to Jesus, right? Because they want to prove that Jesus is wrong. So Jesus, instead of talking about what happened after die, Jesus talked about how God is with us right now, how God loves us right now. It's not important to think of afterlife, because God is here with us right now. God loves so much us right now. So you're not right to ask me that kind of question, right? Because Jesus knows it's tricky. So what's the point today? Today, we know God is love and God's help. God is here just right now. We can then share this God's love, compassion, and his share with the others, right? Right now, not for far away, no far distant future, but right now. This is very important. We can experience in God's kingdom right now, among us, right? God's kingdom is not far away. It's not out there. God's kingdom is here now at time, at this season of Christmas. It's for time for joy. It's for time for love. It's for time for compassion. So we have to practice. We have to exercise this God's teaching into practice. We share things with our neighbor. We share our love, our compassion with our neighbors. That's the God wants us to do right now. All right? Let's pray. Please repeat after me. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for the being the God of living.
Thank you for being the God of living.
For loving us.
For loving us.
For being with us.
For being with us.
Right here and right now.
Right here and right now.
Thank you, Jesus, and amen.
Thank you, Jesus, and amen.
Let us pray. God of justice and joy, we turn to your word to hear your will and your wisdom for our times. Open our hearts and minds by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, so that we might hear what you're saying to the church through Christ, our friend and Savior. Amen. Amen. It's time for scripture readings.
Yes, Dale, would you please come forward? We've had our prayer of illumination, so you can go right into Isaiah.
Good morning.
Good morning.
First scripture reading is from Isaiah 35, 1 to 10. Joy of the redeemed. The desert and the parched land will be glad. The wilderness will rejoice and blossom like the crocus. It will burst into bloom. It will rejoice greatly and shout for joy. The glory of Lebanon will be given to it, the splendor of Carmel and Sharon. They will see the glory of the Lord, the splendor of our God. Strengthen the feeble hands, steady the knees that give way. Say to those with fearful hearts, be strong, do not fear, your God will come. He will come with vengeance, with divine retribution, he will come to save you. Then will the eyes of the blind be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then will the lamb leap like a deer and the mute tongue shout for joy. Water will gush forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. The burning sand will become a pool, the thirsty ground bubbling springs. In the haunts where jackals once lay, grass and reeds and papyrus will grow. And a highway will be there. It will be called the Way of Holiness. It will be for those who walk on that way. The unclean will not journey on it. Wicked fools will not go about on it. No lion will be there, nor any ravenous beast. They will not be found there. But only the redeemed will walk there. And those the Lord has rescued will return. They will enter Zion with singing. Everlasting joy will crown their heads. Gladness and joy will overtake them, and sorrow and sighing will flee away. The responsive psalm this morning is 146, 5 to 10. I will read the odd numbers. Please, congregation, read the even numbers. Blessed are those who help is the Lord, is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord, their God.
He is the maker of heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them. He remains faithful forever.
He upholds the cause of the oppressed and gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets prisoners free.
The Lord gives sight to the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous.
The Lord watches over the foreigner and sustains the fatherless and the widow, but he frustrates the ways of the wicked.
The Lord reigns forever. God owes land for all generations.
The second reading is Luke 20, 27 to 38, the resurrection and marriage. Some of the Sadducees who say there is no resurrection, came to Jesus with a question. Teacher, they said, Moses wrote for us that if a man's brother dies and leaves a wife but no children, the man must marry the widow and raise up offspring for his brother. Now there were seven brothers. The first one married a woman and died childless. The second, 31, and then the third married her. And in the same way, the seven died, leaving no children. Finally, the woman died too. Now then, at the resurrection, whose wife will she be, since the seven were married to her? 34, Jesus replied, the people of this age marry and are given in marriage, but those who are considered worthy of taking part in the age to come and in the resurrection from the dead, will neither marry nor be given in marriage. And they can no longer die, for they are like angels. They are God's children, since they are children of the resurrection. But in the account of the burning bush, even Moses showed that the dead rise. For he calls the Lord, the God of Abraham, and the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. He is not the God of the dead, but of the living, for to him all are alive. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks, Dale, for your scripture readings. Thank you very much. Today, the scripture reading is Luke chapter 20, verse 27 to 38. This is the only place where Sadducees appear in the Gospel of Luke. In the text, Sadducees are asking a question of who is going to be the husband of the widow who married seven brothers on a day of resurrection. This inquiry seems to be a genuine question, but it is not sincere at all. Instead, it is a question that is designed to trick Jesus. To understand the nature of the trick better, we must first ask, who are the Sadducees? The Sadducees were a Jewish group separate from the Pharisees. They were closely aligned with the aristocratic and priestly classes. They rejected the authority of oral tradition, deny the belief in resurrection and angels, and emphasized free will over determinism. With that being said, why do the Sadducees want to trap Jesus? It is because they want to prove that Jesus is wrong. More precisely, that what Jesus is preaching about the kingdom of God is wrong, and therefore nullifying Jesus' authority as Son of God. The Sadducees never won the kingdom of God preached by Jesus in this world, because they were afraid of being taken away from the privileges they enjoyed in the kingdom of Herod. They loved this world so much because the kingdom of Herod has given them wealth and power. They wish to live forever in this earthly kingdom, and for this reason, they are denied the sacred space of the kingdom of God as opposed to the profane space of Herod's kingdom, as well as life after death or bodily resurrection. It has several implications for us today. First, we should not limit God's truth by our human idea because of our social or economic status in this world. Some rich or privileged Christian may not wish to believe in the bodily resurrection because of the privileged status they enjoyed in society, just like the Sadducees of Jesus' day. However, whether they believe or not, it is a biblical truth proclaimed by Jesus. Instead of denying or attacking it, they should accept it as truth, regardless of who they are or what they have, and prepare themselves as one who is considered worthy of resurrection. How many of you have heard of a prosperity gospel? The prosperity gospel is centered on the material blessing or success in life. They use the same Bible, but they interpret it differently in order for the Bible to fit their purpose. It is similar to Sadducees' tactics, blending biblical truth with a fleshly ambition to satisfy human desires. Granted, we might also have used some biblical truth for our own purposes or arguments. We should stop if we did, because the biblical truth is not to be used for one's own argument. Pastor Choi, the founder of the Full Gospel Church, who had been famous for prosperity gospel, died last year. His congregation has been famous for the large scale of the church building, its number of members, and its annual budget. It has more than 500,000 members as a single church, and its annual budget is assumed to be several billions. He began his ministry with a tent church in the suburb of a city with a few members in the early 60s. What is his gospel? It is a threefold blessing. God wants to bless your body, mind, and soul. So we have right to receive those blessings from God. And these are the signs of divine blessing if you are healthy, rich, and successful in your life. In his sermon, he interprets the biblical text from the perspective of these threefold blessings. The problem is that the divine justice, righteousness, mercy, and peacemaking and repentance are missing from his messages. It looks plausible, but it is a fake gospel. It looks like a premium Louis Vuitton bag, but it is a fake Louis Vuitton. It's an imitation. It looks like a fish and chip, but the fish is not real, but it's made of flour with the artificial fish flavors. Jesus on a cross is not the blessing of money, health, or success in life, but of suffering, love, and confession, and repentance. Another point in the account of Jesus' reply to Sadducees is that true marriage can be found in union with God. In verse from 34 to 35, Jesus replies that the people of this age marry or in a given marriage, but those who are worthy of taking part in that age and in the resurrection from the dead, no longer can marry, but will be like an angel. What a revolutionary teaching it is. Jesus says that the resurrection at the resurrection, existence will go back to the pristine Zoe in union with God and to God's creation order before the fall in the Garden of Eden. Jesus implies that the marriage has a purpose for our existence on earth. The purpose is to enjoy companionship and love and ultimately be in union with God. As it says in Book of Genesis, chapter 2, verse 5, God said, "Let us create a man according to our image and likeness." We are created in God's image and likeness. It means that we have to go back to the way we should be, because God's work in creation must be completed in union with God. God is calling us back to our original state through the resurrection, and we will find the full joy and pristine purity in our reunification with the Creator. Jesus argues that the marriage is returning to the way we should be in God. How can we go back? We see several hints from Jesus' mention of two types of people. Ones who follow this age or the age of resurrection, either one or the other. The candidate for the resurrection is those who live according to the word of God instead of the trend of this world. The Bible invites us to live according to the creation principle, living by obeying God's words and walking with God. Do not listen to a voice other than God. It is hard to serve two masters. Jesus asked for our determination by suggesting to choose either God or the world. We can keep our feet in both worlds. We should stand in either the sacred space or the profane space. Finally, this text has an implication for how Jesus cares for the oppressed, specifically women. In the argument of Sadducees, they present the widow as an object only useful for the continuation of a family lineage. Because of their legalism and pursuit of worldly gratification, the Sadducees could only view things in ways which benefit their own interest. However, Jesus responds and shows us that in the original creation, both men and women were designed with the same purpose, to respect and help each other. God always seeks to restore balance and justice to his creation. While men and women are distinct genders and roles, we are all equal as God's children, which is contrary to Sadducees' representation of the widow. So what do we know from this text? Simple. It is that happy wife, happy life. Brother and sister, in light of the passage we have read in Luke 20, chapter 20, I urge you to trust in God's sovereignty. As the Sadducees try to trap Jesus, you may find that you also feel as if people are trying to cast nets for your feet. It seems that the Sadducees' logic is temporally correct and dominant, but in the end, they collapsed in the face of the truth. In the same way, we too must hold on to our faith, realizing that some logic or reason that denies the truth may shake us for a while, but eventually it will fall in front of the truth. Because God's word is ultimate sword, ultimate weapon. Even the Sadducees were in awe at Jesus' reply and did not try to snare him afterwards because of Jesus' knowledge of truth. Know and trust that God is in control. A piece of dark cloud may cover the sun for a while, but not forever, never. May God give you strength and wisdom in your seeking to enter the sacred space. Amen.
Amen.
Our responsive hymn is from 123. My soul gives glory to my God. Please be still.
specific. Apologize, everybody had the wrong words there.
Let us pray. God of all creation, every creature finds its way to rejoice in your presence. The desert blooms, a mountaintop glistens, a stream makes the music flow over us. We give you thanks for the joy in nature, which can lift our hearts. Thank you for the joy we can share with each other. For familiar songs on our lips, for greeting from old friends, for the excitement of children in this season, and for the promise born again in us as we anticipate Jesus' birth. God who makes all things new, renew our life together. We remember those who have grown weaker through months of isolation, through changing economic circumstances, through aging or illness, through hunger and homelessness. Fill empty lives with meaning and purpose. Show us how to share what we have in ways that are generous and dignified. God who makes all things new, renew our life together. Renew in us all the joy that comes from the assurance of your love for us in Christ Jesus. For we gather our prayers together in the words he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. This Sunday, we celebrate the advent of joy, rising us through Jesus Christ. Think of your gift as seeds of that joy in which we can plant in the world God loves for the sake of Christ.
Donations can be provided to St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church through our affiliation with CanadaHelps.org. Go to www.CanadaHelps.org/en/dn/56495. Or donations can be mailed or delivered to St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church, 9860 Keel Street, Vaughan, Ontario, L6A, 3Y4. And friends, I appreciate all the donations that are provided. Now let us stand for our doxology.
Let us pray. God, our judge and our jury, receive our gifts as seeds of gratitude for your gift to us in Christ Jesus. Bless these seeds with the growth so that joy will blossom for people depleted by challenges and places overwhelmed by scarce resources. Be their justice and their joy through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
And good morning once again, everybody. A couple of announcements. I see the mitten tree is filling up. That's wonderful to see. I think we probably have about 1 week left to, if you'd like to make contributions to that, and appreciate everybody who has done that. And our Christmas Eve service, so that will be a Saturday, December the 24th, will be at 7:30 p.m. Right here. And same connection for those who are coming online. Use the same connection details as you do every Sunday morning. And for everybody else, look forward to seeing you here in the sanctuary. Any other announcements? Oh, yes, team. Okay. I'll repeat that for those who are at home. Okay. So Tina has graciously provided a couple of baskets, one for the Chum Children's Toy Drive. And so if you'd like to bring an unwrapped toy, remember, not just the young, there's also teenagers who might like to get a gift on Christmas too that are also in need. So think about that in terms of a unwrapped toy. And so please drop that off by next Sunday. And also there's a basket for Yellow Brick House, and which is a women's shelter that services women here in York Region that has been supported quite often by our group here at St. Andrews. So again, thank you for that. Oh, and is our session meeting tomorrow? Good, I'm glad you just told me that. So there is a session meeting tomorrow. So if you have any issues that you'd like to be brought before the session, please talk to your elder or any of the elders if you don't know who your elder is. Thank you very much. And now, friends, our mission moment. In Nepal, 70-year-old Donnie Gartry found a boil on the sole of her foot. When she sought treatment, Donnie received the diagnosis of leprosy. Despite taking medication for a year, Donnie's wound kept coming back. One day, Donnie's friend told her about the Presbyterian World Service and Development supported Shining Hospital, a Christian hospital run by the International Nepal Fellowship, where she thought Donnie could get more successful treatment. And Donnie says, "Every time I visit the Shining Hospital with my wounded foot, the nurses always welcome me and give the best medical care. They always show love and care while dressing my wounds." So friends, if you'd like to help assistance like the Shining Hospital in Nepal through Presbyterian World Service and Development, I do recommend that you fill in that box on your giving envelope about Presbyterian World Service and Development, and all the gifts that are dedicated for that purpose go there. So again, thank you to all the gifts that we receive here at St. Andrews to allow us to continue our work both here and through our partnerships with others. Thank you very much. And now let us stand for our closing hymn, For a Thousand Tongues to Sing. It's number 374 in the hymn book. Could have found a much easier version for that one. Sorry, everybody. Well, please stay remain standing for the benediction.
Look, record Jesus saying, the kingdom of God is within you. So go with the courage, carrying seeds on of the kingdom, sowing justice, kindness, and mercy in Jesus' name. Receive the benediction. And take with your blessing of God who made you, the Christ who made you, and the Spirit who gives you life. Amen.
And friends, for those here in the sanctuary, remind you that there is a time of fellowship in the fellowship hall through the doors where you see the exit sign. And I do welcome you all to join us for that time. For those who are leaving us or those who are at home, I wish you all a blessed week. And a thank you to Paul for being with us this week.
A big
thank
you.
We're going to be having him back a couple of times in the next little while. So I'm sure you'll be enjoying that as well. So friends, may you now go in peace.
And we thank Alan's mom for the lovely poinsettias in the front.
I got to say, looking at the camera, the beautiful red, they're gorgeous. Again, thank you very much.